Hey folks, Dagan here from PMTVUK, and today I have the absolute pleasure of sharing with you our guitar gear rig rundown with the one and only Doug Aldrich. Currently on tour in the UK with the Dead Daisies, Doug is an absolute legend. He's graced the stage with some amazing bands over the years like the Dead Daisies, Whitesnake and Dio, to name just a few. Now, as a lot of you will know, being in the music game, technical failures can come with the territory. And sadly, our audio recorder had a bit of a meltdown during our chat with Doug. However, Doug is such a legend, we didn't want our meeting to go to waste, so we've done our best to tweak the audio and add subtitles to make it the best it can be. Doug's guitar still sounds absolutely kick-ass though. That wasn't affected. That is one hella amazing guitar tone. Huge thank you to Doug and the entire Dead Daisies crew. Right, that's enough talking. Let's get into the video. Enjoy.
Doug Aldrich, thank you so much for joining me here today. It's an absolute pleasure. Huge fan of your modern day guitar hero. Thanks for taking the time to talk to us today, man.
Of course, thanks for having us. IBMT Rock.
Thanks, man. Well, you guys are on the cusp of your UK tour. You're rehearsing here in Birmingham for the tour. Are you excited for the UK Winter 2022 tour?
I'm not too excited. Yes, of course. I'm very excited. It's going to be great.
Yeah, the UK absolutely adore you, and I can't wait to see you on stage here in the UK. But today we're here to talk about your lovely guitars and some pedal boards, because you are a Les Paul and Marshall lover. Let's talk about one of the most iconic guitars in your arsenal.
It's full circle. I started with a Goldtop when I was a kid.
Yeah.
And little by little, experimented with some other things. And then, you know, when I started working with Dio, I went back to Les Paul a little bit. And then, David Coverdale said, "Oh, I'm glad you're playing Les Pauls because that's what I really love." You know, he's like, "Cool." So I got this. This is a 2008 reissue, 57 reissue, and affectionately known as the Black Eye.
What drew you to the love of the gold song? Was there like inspirations as a kid, or was it just the fact that it sparkles gold?
When I was a kid, my sister's boyfriend had a gold song. So, let me back up. I had a department store copy of the Sunroots Les Paul. And it was really bad guitar, but it was my first one. And I liked it. But my sister's boyfriend said, "I got a Gibson Les Paul Goldtops." I thought the Sunroots wasn't good. So I thought it was like gold. So he goes, like, $300. It was a 1973 Deluxe. And it was $300. And I go, okay. So I earned about $125, and my parents let me the rest pay back. And I go and I look at the case and it says Gibson. I said, "Oh, I'm not really Gibson." So I go, "It's real Gibson." And then I think you're 11 or 12 or 13, wherever I was. Probably 12 or 13. It was cool. But I grew to love the Goldtop the most of all.
Yeah.
It's just feels right. It looks right to me in my eye. I just see it. If I'm not playing it, if it's in the room sitting there, it just always looks beautiful. But then since then, I was. Been trying to get as many different color Les Pauls as I could get.
But the gold top always gravitates towards you, because the gold top looks great on you, and you look great with the gold top. One thing I'm curious about though is 57 reissue.
Yeah.
Is there a specific reason for 57, or was it simply because that's the last year of the gold top before the person had the humbuckers and stuff?
It was my Deluxe had the mini humbuckers. And they were good, but then at that time, DeMarzio came out with Super Distortion and the. Just my PAF. So I had that guitar routed for those. So I always liked the humbuckers sound.
Speaking of humbuckers, that's a nice little segue into what you've got here, guys.
These
are good close to with John Suhr for years. I've got some very good friends. I'm a big fan of your signature pickups. If you don't mind speaking about them for a bit, that'd be awesome.
I love them. So,
The latest.
I've always loved different humbuckers, and from the PAFs all the way to, you know, Seymour Duncan was making some, and like I said, DeMarzio. And I got to be friends with John Suhr in, I guess it was around 1991 something, maybe it was a little later, but we got to be friends, and he started working at Fender. And I had a Les Paul with P90s in it, and I asked, he said, "Hey, if you want, I can rewind those. I'm really into pickups." And so he had already modded this amp for me right here. This is the first one he did for me. And so I trusted him, you know, and you're gonna like this. So I got this, it's so loud and clean, it's brilliant. Then he moved away from Fender and started, went back to his old company, Suhr Guitars, which are now legendary.
Yeah.
And John is just, he's just a genius, you know, and his son Kevin now is Suhr, and he's a genius. This is crazy how any situation can come up, like we call John and Doug over.
Everything he touches turns to gold. Like, I've never played one Suhr pickup or one Suhr guitar that I haven't immediately bonded with.
Yeah.
It's incredible.
I said, John, he goes, what do you want? You want to do a pickup together? I said, yeah, he sent me 4 prototypes. I told him I wanted it because basically I wanted it to be a little bit hotter. I wanted it to be warm and punchy, not compressed.
Yeah.
And he sent me 4 different versions. And we narrowed it down to 1 of those, and then we made a couple little tweaks to it.
Yeah.
And this is it. This is the pickup. It's just,
if you wouldn't mind me getting it,
you can hear the strings, you can hear all the notes to it, you know. A basic, nice sound.
That is not a basic sound. That is a sound which will make the hairs on your back stand up.
It's basically like, you know, a stock pickup sounds great always, yeah, and it's got a lot of air to it. But these, when I get used to these pickups, there's no going back.
What were they based on? Were they based on something like a 59 that you wanted to, like a PAF you wanted to make hotter, or was it something else you had in mind?
It's kind of similar to a Gibson Custom Shop number 3 pickup. So speaking of, you know, talking about the amps, so you guys, this is the first one that John got his hands on because I blew it up. And he was actually testing out transformers for custom audio electronics amp. And so he had a transformer that he picked and liked. They must have sent him a really good one because they were trying to get a contract. And he goes, I can put that one in your head. So that's what's in there.
Yeah.
This one, he copied it. So it's a crazy guy. No, this is 1979. This is 1978. And I bought this.
Simple JMP.
Except for John.
Except for John's secret seasoning.
The only thing, aside from John putting a little more gain on it, is a really nice effect that he did.
Oh, cool, yeah.
Similar to his custom mod.
Yeah, what is it about John's mods that he's so much? Because obviously back in the day, if you say he bought these,
it's
the mods and stuff, so what is it about John's mods?
It's the, being on the bottom of that, they're not compressing. Sometimes it's great, no flexing, when you kind of squish it down, it makes it
feel muscular. These are so
these are big open and. See, he put really bigger filter caps in so he can take that home.
Yeah. If you wouldn't mind giving us some more tones, man.
Yeah.
So Doug, this is your lovely burst. What's this guy?
So this is a 59 CSU. I did change the frets. It's got the Suhr pickups in it.
Actually, speaking about frets before, do you just go standard fret wire, or do you have a certain fret size?
Dunlop wire.
Big, small?
Big, 6100. 6105 sometimes, depending on what guitar it is.
Yeah.
A little thinner, but still high.
Yeah, for sure.
But for bending and stuff, I like to get my finger underneath this a little bit.
Is this the famous guitar that we saw a video of wearing all puppy chewed the knobs?
Yes.
Is this one? Yes. Oh, that's a chew,
She chewed right here.
So you got a puppy during COVID and it chewed the knobs of the guitar, or something like that. Yeah
this is the guitar that, it's on loan to me. One of the guys at Gibson.
I think it's yours now because we choose.
Yeah, that's true. You wouldn't want it back. But it's a beautiful guitar and it sounds great, plays great. I'm just breaking it in. We've had it for a couple of years now.
Yeah, so is this a backup to Black Eye?
No, I just
depending on your mood.
We have some the black guys went number one.
Yeah, which has been for years, and so many different projects and stuff. It's like, I call it like with you, that's black pick our goals up.
But we have some different tunings going on, so a lot of times, well, instead of me retuning, we got a segue in the set that the songs try to go together. It's easier for me to just swap out the guitar sometimes. So, but it's a great guitar.
Yeah, is there anything you find that different between the 57 and 59 Pro bottleneck, or does it depend on your mood?
This has a little bit thinner, neck. It's a little more C-shaped. That 57 has got a little more shoulder.
Yeah, besides the frets and the pickups, not anything else on this guitar? Strap it up, so that's straight up from... That's a beautiful kind of fade, isn't it?
Oh, well? Yeah, it's really sweet.
The flame is ridiculous on that front.
Well, so I saw this at Leo Scala. Leo Scala is a friend of mine.
I've seen you play tons of Salix Scala guitars. They're stunning things.
He built me a gold, kind of a, in the tradition of a 54 gold top. It is insane, and it's at home right now. I had it on tour earlier this year, but
all this angle, I like
it. Anyway, long story, but it's an insane guitar. He called it the Golden Ruby, and he was finished on that guitar. I went down and he had this guitar there. Gibson had asked him to do some nail lines, which was kind of maybe relic it, take some parts of that. I go, whoa, hold on. I saw this guitar, I went home, I couldn't stop thinking about it.
Was it because of the flame, like the unique flame, or was it just...
I played it, the way it felt, the flame, everything. So I couldn't stop thinking about it. That's when I know I'm in trouble. So I called Gibson and I talked to Cesar. I said, look, I know I told you I never quite needed it much because I got stuck in the knob or something.
Like that? Yeah.
But I saw this guitar at Leo Scala's place and I fell in love with it. What could it take for me to acquire that guitar get an artist to do it with? So we'll go pick it up and figure it out.
Cesar is a lovely guy, and obviously that guitar's here right now, so
yes.
I think everything's worked out just right.
Well, we'll see. This is a 1973 custom. Same thing, it's got uncovered pickups, actually, John Suhr. I just always liked it. I saw Joe Perry a long time ago with everything black.
Yeah.
And I thought it looked cool.
It's one of the coolest things, a black custom of black uncovered pickups. It is the Joe Perry, Steve Jones. Jones, he has a couple of black custom with the Wilco caps as well. It's just.
So, I had a black custom that I traded for a 68 piece, actually, single quality.
And yeah, maybe.
And I always used that black custom, so I bought this one back in like the late 90s. And this is the guitar I used on most of Dio record that I did with Ronnie. Used it live with him.
It's good.
For the Sabbath stuff. And then David saw me playing it. He really liked it. And I was using this kind of exclusively as my main guitar with Whitesnake. But then I started thinking, like, it's kind of a John Sykes type thing. You know, in Whitesnake, you think of the black Les Paul custom, you think of Sykes.
Yeah.
And that's when I kind of gravitated back towards my gold top.
What was the kind of, because customs and standards are quite different customs and Goldtops. Do you find them quite different to play, or when does this come out during the
set? I kind of get used to them all. They're all different a little bit. So you got to get used to them, you got to get to know them.
Different kind of flavors. What do you fancy that day? Do I fancy a custom day? Do I fancy a Goldtop day?
It's always a Goldtop. This guitar is one of the, it might be even better sound. My ears.
Judging by how much wear is on it, obviously it must be a good guitar because it played a lot.
Yeah.
How much of that has he eaten as well?
A lot of it.
A lot of it's used.
Definitely this was. Unfortunately, that was me. But this guitar.
Every scratch tells a story.
Someone, somewhere, Tony Iommi scratched the dishes. But he did a really light touch.
So it's somewhere got Iommi's initials on it.
Yeah.
That's cool.
We're in Birmingham. It's somewhere.
It's strange. He's just down the road now, so it's never quick call. Right. Again, comes, we're baby.
It's a really strange way he writes his initials. It's kind of evil.
But that does not surprise me at all.
So yeah, I see he came to a deal gig I was doing in 2005, and I had this guitar. We were doing some Sabbath, obviously. We were doing Voodoo. I was part of the deal. I said, Ronnie, I'll do the tour, but we got to do Voodoo.
Yeah.
And he goes, okay.
Absolutely badass.
Yeah.
Okay, if we could talk about your pedal board,
you've done that. Yes. All right, so basically, everybody's probably knows that I always like cables. A friend of mine said, I work at this company called Electrosonics, and it's an amazing unit. And he said, why don't you test it out, try it against your cable? And it was this close, I really couldn't really tell. It was more of a, it gets stuck in your brain. Like if somebody tells you you're playing through old PAF pickups all on
It's the age of the guitar players, we're in our heads, man.
Yeah. But it sounded great, but I didn't need it at the time. I was still using the cable with the Dead Daisies, and we were doing some shows with Johnny Depp and Alice Cooper.
Yeah, the Hollywood Vampires.
And they had all these obstacles on their stage. We're supporting, so we can't move their things.
Well, like pedals or flame boxes and
smoke bombs. Flame boxes and fans and this. And I was just finding myself getting caught up all the time. And I'm running around with the cable getting stuck.
Yeah.
You know, so finally I went for the electrosonics, and I gotta say, it made life a lot easier. I can be mobile.
So is that your favorite wireless because it has the nuance of the case?
It really feels, you can adjust the gain how you, so that it feels like the cable that you're used to. And it's, it doesn't seem to compress the sound well. It seems pretty pure.
Nice.
I mean, it's quick, you know, it's not a delay to it.
So good.
So the thing I also liked about it is that the receiver is at the pedal board.
Yes. Cool. Yeah, that's it. Let's check out the pedal board.
All right.
Where do you go through the wireless? The wireless. The
wireless.
The wireless.
And then I'm going to the MXR phase ID just for fun, just to have it for different sounds, like slow Van Halen or faster. And from there into a Dunlop custom audio electronic wah, which is so great.
As a fan, it's such a pleasure to be sitting here watching you play right now. Our fucking mind is blown. Thank you so much.
Thank you guys. I really appreciate the support and coming out.
Yeah, for sure. Now, so I'm last couple of the phase 90 first, sorry. Any reason why you aren't using the block logo over the strip logo? Or is that just kind of you?
I just, because that's a newer one, and the new stuff, something for me, a lot of times I take the stuff on the road and it takes a little more
looking care. After, yeah.
Yes. So this is one that the guy sent me, and it just...
It ticks the box, man. It ticks the Van Halen box, it ticks the Leslie's box.
I don't need it very much, but it's fun to mess with sometimes.
Sure.
The wah is definitely something I love.
Yes.
It's my whammy bar. Mm.
Yeah. Do you go into your signature magic box?
Yes.
This is something special. I love this pedal. It's so awesome.
A lot of times I just use it for a little slight clean boost. Mm-hmm.
Stage, you can feel it though.
Yeah.
You can feel it.
And this is just a regular kind of normal distortion. Kind of heavy gain stuff that's for the, you know, over the top stuff.
So how would you say you change tones during a set? Like, is the Marshall like your main tone, Gibson and Marshall?
Yeah.
You turn this on for specific songs, you turn it on for solos?
All this stuff is really just the spices, let's say. I add a little spice here and there just for fun.
Yeah,
I mean, basically, with what we're doing, we're playing really simple 70s bass rock. You can do it with just the Marshall.
Yeah.
But I love the wah. And I like experimental stuff. So it goes from the wah to the signature pedal. The tuner is in line at a certain point. Sometimes when I use a talk box, I like to do just talk box. Sometimes I like to use both, talk box and the amp. So this way, if I hit the tuner, not only can I tune, but the talk box comes
out. Talk box, that's awesome. Yes.
This right here is a really crazy fuzz. My buddy, who's a guitar tech for Black Crowes, gave me this pedal. Like and it's just a crazy over-the-top fuzz.
It's kind of an over the top fuzz, but it's really fun.
Yeah, so there's an Unifi in there as well.
Yes. Yeah. Nice, and then this is a boost, so I can get a little bit more of a, on these amps, one other thing that John did is put a secondary master, so nice. I can go to it a little bit more. It's just a little bit louder, I gotta see.
Yeah.
In the loop,
all right, cool.
I got Eventide H9, and so I can turn it on here. It's just some basic delay.
Kind of, you can do so much with that pedal. Do you ever sway and do some crazy stuff with it? Or
I
is
don't.
It just like a great delay pedal?
It's just a static delay pedal I use.
Yeah, and what a great delay pedal. Like, it
really is. Awesome. It's insane. And then this delay pedal is set up for craziness. Like, delay and stuff, but it's also...
But that's no fun.
So, all together...
Absolute pleasure. Thank you so much for talking me through all your awesome things.
Thanks, Dagan. Thanks, guys. You're appreciate
blowing my mind.
You.